Yeah, hi. Hi, everyone. My name is Kalyan Dikshit, and my talk is about securing smart home automation with Tower. So it's a very upcoming topic because we have seen many cyber attacks, and I mean, what harmful I mean, it does cause to a infrastructure in a very big way, and it can be fatal if it is not taken properly. So the first question that comes up whenever we speak about home automation is that what is exactly home automation? I mean, why that we have hearing it nowadays more than the previous decade? If you see, like, it has, I mean, the thing is that home automation is always there in. Home automation was always there from even from the 90s, 60s, and 90s, 70s. But the only difference that we have seen is that we have never seen in that in a huge scale. For example, connecting a battery to a bulb is nothing but home automation. Like using a switch to light on a bulb is home automation. But the only thing is that we have never seen the compactness of it in a very smaller scale rather than in a big scale. If you have seen, like, if you search, like, what is exactly home automation, it is nothing but it involves the controlling of all the smaller appliances using a smaller gateway by using a protocol either in Bluetooth or Wi-Fi, so that you could have a entire control in your hand. So the thing is that when we had the technology has been grown exponentially in the last 5 years. In the same way, the home automation has came up from the back to dead, so that, you know, many people who have been thinking like how to automate those stuff for home appliances have increased their working, and they came to know about the new protocols or the new technology that has been existed in this decade, which can help them to make it more successful than the previous decade. Early home automation began with labor-saving machines and self-contained electric or gas-powered home appliances, and also which involves the introduction of washing machines, water heaters, and sewing machines, and etc. But in 2012, in United States, according to the ABI research, around 1.5 million automation systems were installed. So that is just a tip of an iceberg if you have taken the growth rate in the next 5 to 10 years. And first generation was a wireless technology, which involved a few lower rate protocols like Zigbee automation. Then we have seen the artificial intelligence taking their place, and we have this home assistants coming up like Amazon Echo, and we have even AI in a small mobile of ourselves. Then the third generations are nothing but the entire AI making a robotics or making a robot which can take care of the entire grid or a entire neighborhood for it. So the question comes up always is why now? Why now this technology has been so popular, and why we have been hearing it in the last 5 years? So if you have seen the convenience of development of such devices was much harder in the previous decade or in the previous 2 decades, because we didn't have the particular technology or we didn't have the particular protocols which can support those hardware systems. It is the same scenario when Apple thought to introduce a MacBook before the iPod, but the existing technology couldn't be held, so they started with an iPod. Then they later have been moved to MacBook. In the same way, we had the idea, but the problem was that we didn't have the particular hardware and software resources which can support the idea or implement in a very mass scale. And the most important part is that people had a more affordability right now than compared to previous decade, because people income has been increased in a huge and drastic way all around the world. And also people, whenever we have a smartphone coming up every 1 or 2 years, people would like to use the latest technology in it. So the comfortness of using a technology has been increased exponentially or rapidly in the last 3 years. And we have seen that, you know, when we use machines, the wastage of energy will be reduced to the minimum level, or we could achieve a zero rate of wastage. And also you could we travel or we work every time, so it will be much easier to look on our family or to know what is happening in our own home or what is going on in our absence. And also to have a luxury of yourself by sitting at a same place and controlling your entire home by just a click, so that you need not go over for making a coffee, but you can just send a command for the coffee maker saying that I need so and so coffee. And also we have seen that, you know, people started to introduce this smart lock system where you need not carry a hardware or a physical key to your home, but just you using a sensor and a prepaid Bluetooth device, it can unlock it for you. So these are a few of the observations that have been taken in the next 5 to 10 years. And if you see the total expected adoption has been decreased in the next 5 years, but if you see the 5 years from now, especially in the terms of a connected device security system and smart thermostats, has been increased. And recently there have been a great article which says that people have installed more thermostats in the previous 5 years. But always the question comes down to, like, is it secure? The same technology that we have been using for our loved ones or to take care of our home, but is it secured? The question is that it is not secured at this point, because there are many numerous factors which come into the play. I mean, there's a story which I have, like, how I experienced that this can be a very bad way, or a very in a negative way, where a remote hacker can watch over your loved ones, or they can manipulate your key, or they can lock you out of your own home even though you have the key to your home. I mean, when I just went to my sister's house for a weekend, then they had a smart TV, bought it on newly. So the thing was that I was always curious to know, like, how do this smart TV works? So when I was going through the manual, I have came to know that it uses the same Wi-Fi network, so that you can just transmit from all the Netflix or Amazon. But the problem was that when I started a scan for it, like a IP scan, I just came to know that there are other devices which are connected in the same network, which happen to have a very less authentication or vulnerable to authentication bypassing. But when I was able to access the main interface hub, I could see the entire home of theirs and the entire cameras, their thermostats and their heaters and everything. So by just a single click, I can just make sure that they don't use it anymore in their future. But I could also make sure that, you know, it reacts in a very weird way, so that, you know, it makes them impossible to use it for the next usage. So this is how the hackers list have a look about your home, like the cameras, the thermostats, or the smart applications which are connected to it. So the question is, like, why are they not secured? So if we see the problem is that whenever we have a devices with this type of technology, we don't have a dedicated service support for it in the first place, because whenever we contact a customer care, they will say that we will try to send it to our engineering team, but you never hear from them until unless it has been affected in a very huge way, in a massive scale. And also there are no frequent or updates or patches for it, because these devices are not their primary concern for their income. So they just release the device, and the patches or updates or the vulnerabilities which has been identified to it are not patched in the next 3 months or the next 90 days or the next 6 months too. So in this scenario, the attacks on this increase in a much easier way, because after a vulnerability has been in the wild, and after a few days it comes to the public platform. So whenever it has been in the public platform, any person who is well known in that particular field can take advantage of it and just create a huge cyber attack on the entire systems in the world. And also we don't have a lifetime support as we have for open source operating system for Ubuntu. If you take, they have increased from 3 years to 5 years the LTS support for the next releases. Now, but we don't have any lifetime support for this type of devices because they just do it for in a minimal scale and they don't take care for the next 3 years the regular updates or the regular patches which has to be released, and the end of life of these devices are reached very early, because for example if they release a version 1 system in the first quarter, by the third quarter they will be coming up with the version 2 of the system, but by the time the V2 version comes out, the V1 version V1 version doesn't have a support for it for the next 1 year. So they force people to buy the V2 version, saying that we had a huge upgrade in this and those. But what about the V1 devices which are in the market and which are connected to the internet? And we have seen a lot of times that there is an improper or broken authentication systems which are very poor to be imagined. For example, if you try to pen test a system, if you cannot log in, but if you can go to the source code, there will be a source code which is similar to login.html ID equals to 1, but if you change the ID equals to 2, we have seen many cases which have a redirection mechanism which can redirect you to the login page by just changing a single parameter in it. And also we do have a hard-coded passwords installed in the firmware, which is easier to extract by using the tools like Binwalk and others, and strings and hexas, so that we could know which firmware has been in that. And also we do have a backdoor accounts installed by the company, so that they could push patches for the future upgrades, but they never do that. Only just for namesake they just have a backdoor account so that they can know the data, or they can sell your data to the interested parties for it. And the question comes up is that how can we make sure that we do have a very secured home automation system. For this we could we have a home open source home automation software which have proper updates, and the code has been altered regularly, and the patches has been released in a very fortnight or a monthly manner. But the question is how secure are the open source softwares itself? How can we use an open source software in the most efficient way? So at this point, we have around five open source home automation softwares. So they are KalaOS and Domotic and Home Assistant, OpenHAB and OpenMotix, and even all the five open source softwares support the minimal hardware system, and they do have a dedicated support, and they do have a code in the open source platform on the GitHub, and they get updates frequently. And also the software is audited, and any security issues has been reported to the internal team will get immediately patched in the next 24 hours to 72 hours. So the question is that how do we, even though we install the software, how do we make sure that no one can access the home automation network except you? So for that we'll be using Tor, because Tor has been a great source for people who have been battling the privacy issues, and we have seen a huge spike after the Snowden leak that most people started to use Tor than the previous last decade, and after it, and Tor has gone many changes in terms of the latency issues, and in terms of node attacks, or in terms of timing attacks for it. For this demo we'll be using the open source home automation system called OpenHAB, and So we'd be using a Raspberry Pi 3 with a 8 GB or 16 GB memory card. For that, we'll be instead of using an extra monitor, we could use the Raspberry Pi by going through a headless display by just using a RJ45 Cat 5 cable, so that we could access the UI part by using SSH, and then we'll be using VNC. RDP protocol, so that we could access to the interface part of it. And we would be adding few details in the Tor RC file, since we could create the entire idea is to create a hidden onion site, so that no one can know the URL of the site. And we will be also using a stealth keyword, so that the other nodes even don't know this onion site on it. And we will be also creating a authentication cookie, like in the backend, the encryption key pairs of get generated, so that until unless you have an authentication cookie, you cannot log into your home automation system. So if someone by chance know your onion URL, but they don't even have an access to the website of the system, until unless they do possess the authentication cookie for it. So the if you see the hidden service directory is nothing but the Open Hab 2 is nothing but just a normal software application name, and the hidden port is nothing but which port that we would like to run. In which port we would like to run the authentication system in the Tor Onion site, and the remaining. And the remaining part is the localhost and the open source operating system instance are running on it. And we even add a hidden service authorized client, which specifies that you need a authentication cookie to log into it. So until unless you don't have it, you cannot log in. So we will be adding those three lines of code in the Tor RC file. We will just restart the Tor. And we do have the Tor generates a unique onion address in the host name, and you could get that by using the more command. And after that, in the output of the command, you could see a unique domain name and authentication cookie. The QRST is a sample cookie, but if you add it to your Tor client side access, you can just access the system in that. And the client ASG 2017 is just a name. You can just add a different name, and you can even have a different types of names for it. For example, if you are having three people, you are planning to give access to three people, you could create three generic names, and we have a different three unique onion addresses which are associated with a unique authentication cookies for it. Yeah, you could access your Open Hab 2 for either from your laptop or your mobile phone. For example, if you go for your laptop, you should install the Tor exe file or in the Windows, or you could just install it in the Linux system. Add the hidden auth in the Tor RC file, and add the unique onion address and the authentication cookie. Restart the Tor file from your client side, and coming to the mobile side, you could just install RBOT in Android or iOS. You can just add it in your settings type, and if you use RFox for the accessing onion sites in your mobile phone, you could point it to the unique onion address that we have generated for it, and it works. Yeah, and is there any other questions that you would like to ask? This is a local instance running on the local host. Yeah, this is a unique online address that has been generated for it. And I'm sorry. Okay, sure. I mean, I'll just 1 minute. That's it. Thank you.
Yeah.